me in several places this morning. And if you get your outline out, maybe you're a guest this morning, if you get your outline out, we'll give you something to take home with you. And it's not to throw away or make notes on, right? It's to take home and read over. And maybe there's some things the Lord shows you or some gleanings this morning that you can take home the days from now, begin to reflect upon. But we have to remember the setting of where we're at. The Lord Jesus Christ has, for 3.5 years, He has done nothing but love people. He's done nothing but work miracles. He has done absolutely nothing to harm anybody other than the religious crowd who could not stand Him because He seemed to be winning people over to Him. It was as if His compassion and His love was a magnet for other people. Now, I will be the first to admit to you this morning, we know very well that Jesus had no problem getting a crowd. As a matter of fact, many times in the New Testament, the Bible said that He was either followed or He was thrown by the multitude. But there's only one problem with that. The multitude, 99% of the time, they would only show up because they wanted to see the show. They wanted to see what miracle He's going to do today. I mean, when they woke up in the morning all through Jerusalem, the question was, what is He going to do today? I mean, man, yesterday He fed 5,000 people. Day before that, He made a lame man to walk. Day before that, He made a blind man to see. What's He going to do today? But when it got right down to time to go out and work, there were only a few. You ever notice how when it's time to pull up your sleeves and work, there's only a few?
That's right.
And so in Scripture this morning, the religious crowd have plotted a scheme. They have carried it out to perfection. Judas has played the role. Jesus called Him the son of perdition. He sold the Son of God. Jesus was arrested just outside the Garden of Gethsemane, which is on the Mount of Olives. From there, He was taken to Annas' house. From there, He was taken to Caiaphas' house. From there, He was taken to the Sanhedrin. From there, He was taken to Pilate. From there, He was taken to Herod. From there, He was taken back to Pilate. And from there, He was taken to the cross and then laid in the empty tomb. Now, as He was in the empty tomb, as I said the other night, you and I both know, there's really nothing recorded in Scripture anywhere where those 11 men done anything for the gospel. It was almost as if in the back of their mind, they had made up their mind and decided that Jesus Christ was dead. And as a matter of fact, Peter even said out of his own mouth, I'm going to go back and go fishing, because that's what I was doing before I started following Him. And so in their mind, they don't really know what's going to happen. So the question is this morning, do you really believe it? That's why I've entitled the sermon, What Makes the Resurrection Personal? Do you really know that Jesus is alive, or do you just read about it and you think it's true? Just because you read about it don't mean you really believe it.
Come on.
Are y'all with me? And so in Matthew chapter 20, verse 18 and 19, if you'll stand out of reverence for God's word, I'm going to read two verses this morning that's going to be a springboard into the message. And in Matthew chapter 20, when Jesus is really kind of telling the passion of what's going to unfold, here's what He said. Behold, we go up to Jerusalem. That word we means y'all going with me. We go to Jerusalem, the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn Him to death. And they shall deliver Him to the Gentiles to mock, to scourge, and crucify Him. And the third day He shall rise again. God, this morning, thank You for the promise. Not just the promise that You made these men before You went to Jerusalem, but Lord, the promise that we have today that You never leave us nor forsake us. And so, Lord, I want to ask You this morning, I know there's a lot of folk here, maybe, Lord, they just hearing this message for the first time. Maybe some are hearing it, Lord, for the umpteenth time. But, Lord, help us to be reminded there's a difference in head knowledge and heart knowledge of this whole entire story. And so You take it and use it for Your honor and glory. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. You may be seated. In the introduction in your outline, we must be careful not to just make Easter about holidays, gatherings, and the day we celebrate the resurrection. We must be careful not to make Easter about holidays, gatherings, and just the celebration of the resurrection. There is so much more to the resurrection, yet it must be mixed with faith. There is so much more to the resurrection, and yet it must be mixed with faith. Now listen very carefully while I'm going to tell you that. As we read this, in Hebrews chapter number 4, the Apostle Paul is the writer of the book of Hebrews as far as I'm concerned. There's a great theological debate. But in Hebrews chapter 4, this is what the Apostle Paul said. Don't you listen very carefully. The Apostle Paul said, one, that the gospel has been preached. The resurrection has been preached. But Paul said that all of our preaching to them is worthless. You know why he said that? Because in the end of the verse, he said, all of our preaching is worthless because it's not mixed with faith. That's what the Bible said. He said, well, why is that, preacher? Listen, if your faith has not been placed in Jesus Christ alone, completely and totally, the Bible is nothing but a book. It cannot be alive to you until Jesus Christ is your Lord, Master, and Savior. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so I'm afraid a lot of people today, they know the story, they know the details. I mean, man, they can tell you the Easter story down pat. But the true living resurrection Jesus Christ living within their life is completely nothing more than fathom to them. Number one outline, how can Easter have a great impact on you? How can Easter have a great impact on you, or impact your life, or impact your decisions, or even impact your home and your family? In 8:1, you must first believe it. You must first believe it. I put John 11:25-26 in your outline. Look very closely in your outline. Jesus said it to her. Now, stop, look at me. In John 11, before we get to this verse of Scripture, I had to put all of it in your outline for the sake of time. In John 11, there's a man that was Jesus' very dear friend, and his name was Lazarus. And him and Jesus, I mean, they were close. And the Bible says that Jesus knew that Lazarus was going to die, but he waited 2 days before he went. And on his way to this journey, he receives word that Lazarus has died. And on his way to Lazarus' house, he runs into Lazarus' sister. And in verse 25, this is the conversation. And Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Then watch what he said. He said, do you believe this? Come on. Think about that now. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. Do you really believe this? Now, she did not say yes, she did not say no. What she answered was, in verse 27, you read when you get home, what she said was, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. John, you know what? That was enough for Jesus. You know why? Because the only way to believe that he could really be the Messiah was to really believe he could conquer death. And so when you begin to look at that word believe in verse number 25 and 26, you can write this down if you want to. It comes from the Greek word pistuo, and it means to be persuaded in and to completely trust. And so what he was asking was, are you completely persuaded and do you completely trust that I am the one? Now, let me be very honest about this, all right? A man's beliefs will be portrayed in his life. If a man says he believes something and ain't portrayed in his life, he really don't believe it. He admits it, but he don't believe it. And the problem in our day and time is people say they believe in the resurrection. People say they believe Jesus is alive. People say that they believe heaven is real. People say they believe hell is real, but they live as though they don't believe any of that. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so the question today is, do you really and truly, think about this now, search your heart. Do you really believe he's alive? And I'll be honest with you. If you ain't a born-again Christian, you ain't got the ability to believe.
That's right.
I prove it to you in Scripture. The Holy Spirit is the only thing that can give a man the ability to believe such an event. You say, why, preacher? Well, if you really believe he's alive, don't you think he deserves your worship? If you really think he's alive, don't you believe he deserves us to serve him? Hello, somebody. So why is it that so many Christians say they believe Jesus is alive, but yet they don't want to live for him? That's insane. That can't happen. But here's what Jesus said one day. He told the religious crowd, he said, you honor me with your mouth and your lips, but your heart is not even close to me. I listened to an interview the other day that really, it was kind of like one of the wow factors. I listened to an interview the other day, and this is what was asked. They asked Hollywood actors, they said, how is it that you can take something completely fake? I mean, here we are, preachers of the gospel, preaching our heart out, and it's as if nobody even cares. And here you are getting paid millions of dollars to take something that is completely fake, completely phony, and completely non-existent. And you are able to take something completely fake and engulf people to the point that they shed tears, they spend money. I mean, they will go all out. I mean, you just grab their emotions. And this was the answer. They said, because we are able to take something fake and make it look real, and you take something real and make it look fake. See, we say we believe the Bible, but why do we make it appear as though Jesus is not even alive? Hello? I know it's 8 o'clock, but wake up. Were y'all not honest? So listen, before he ever continued to Lazarus' house, he said, do you really believe this? Now think about it. Up until this point, Leonhoff, let's be honest. They've seen a lot of things. See, it's easy to witness Jesus do something other, everybody else's life, but when it comes to your life, that's where it gets real. She has a need, not Jairus' daughter. She has a need. And when you begin to look at verse number 26, he ends by saying, and whosoever believes in me and shall never die, do you believe this? And then beat under one is still empty. You say, preacher, why is it important that we be faithful to Jesus Christ? Can I tell y'all something? When a person is going through the trials of life, I mean, when they're in a dire strait situation, when a man is in a position in his life that he absolutely teetotally has got nothing to hold on to but Jesus Christ, when a man is in that situation, Leonhoff, and he latches on to Christ and won't let go, you know what that tells me? That tells me he's got an intimate connection. When everything's groovy in life, that ain't where you judge a man. You can tell where a man's at when he's in the pit of despair, and then he realizes he's got nothing left but Christ. It's kind of where Mark was at. She got nowhere to go. And then in your scripture, Mark 16, and he said to them, be not affrighted. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He said in 3 words, he is risen. That was not proposed as a question. It was proposed as a statement. He is not here. He is risen. Behold the place where they laid him. Now, let's think about something for a minute. If the religious crowd, and they were the religious crowd in Jesus' day and time, even when we get into the first century church in Acts and Romans and the unfolding of the missionary journey, if the religious crowd really and truly wanted to silence Christianity, I mean, if the religious crowd really and truly wanted to just shut the apostles completely up, there's only one thing they had to do, just one, present his body. Did y'all hear what I say? If they could have presented his body, David, they would have shut down the first New Testament church. If they could have presented his body, they would have silenced those 12 apostles. I mean, why in the world could they not do something as simple as provide his body? Can I tell y'all something? For 2,000 years, the world has been trying to present it, and they still can't do it. One small factor, show me his body. That's all you got to do. In December, I was in Israel, beautiful country. I was able to go to the garden tomb, Philip, where they buried him. Can I tell you something? It's still empty. There's nobody there. But listen, they knew that it was a bogus story from the get-go. Let me tell you. Now, y'all ever notice how when God does something, he does it in such a way that you can't deny that he done it? You ever notice that? Now, think about this for a minute. Jesus could have been beaten to death outside the city wall, buried in a cave somewhere. Nobody even knew nothing about it. And they could have said somebody stole his body, and they would have believed it, Leonhoff. Very, very open statement. But think about this. Jesus, Brother Jack, he was arrested in front of the multitude. He was presented before the Roman leader, Pilate. He was taken to Herod. I mean, publicly, he was a display for all the world to see. He was hung on a tree in front of multitudes of people. He was taken down, Cata, put inside of a tomb. And then the darndest thing happened. They took a band of Roman soldiers and placed them outside the tomb. Can I ask y'all something? Why would a dead man worry you? I'm just saying. Why was it that they were so terrified? Now listen, they were so terrified that he was going to get out of that tomb that they put Roman soldiers there to guard. Does that not sound ludicrous to you? Listen, I've done a lot of funerals in my life, but I ain't never went back and said he's away. Alright? Ain't never done it, alright? They put a band of Roman soldiers still outside the tomb to guard it. And you know the people walking through the city laying up are asking, what in the world are y'all doing? And then, we are supposed to believe that 11 ragtag fishermen and one accountant who was a thief, we are supposed to believe that them 11 fishermen, if you will, Mike Jackson, whooped all these Roman soldiers, took his body out, and left town with him. If y'all think about it, that's what they're asking us to believe. Amen? something happens to prove it was all a lie. Because in biblical day and time, if you were a Roman soldier and you were guarding a body or you were guarding a prisoner and you lost it, you were supposed to take his place. Those Roman soldiers should have been executed on the spot. But what did they say? Just tell everybody that his disciples came and stole his body. And then he said, and we will protect you. You know why they protected them? Because they knew them Roman soldiers should have been killed. Nobody with a brain in their head would have believed that story. Nobody. But they were desperate to convince people that he was not alive. And guess what? It didn't work. The first New Testament church, the Bible tells us, they turned the world upside down. Can I tell you something? Quit telling people about you and just tell people about Jesus. That's all it takes. It's real simple. And so in this story, if you will, as things begin to unfold in Mark 16:6, it's very simple. Jesus is not here. And then number two, the ones impacted by the resurrection. The ones impacted by the resurrection. Eight and unto those that have gone before us. Those that have gone before us. 1 Thessalonians 4:14. For if we believe, you circle that word if, alright? That word if means it's got to be determined and persuaded and decided in your heart that he is alive. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, look at me. It's not enough to believe he was crucified, everybody's going to die. But you got to go a step further, Lynn, and believe he died and rose again. Are y'all? That's vitally important. Watch that verse. Even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. Now, can I just be honest about this for a minute? Those 11 disciples, it would not be 12 until Matthias was brought in the book of Acts, because when Judas went out and hung himself, they went from 12 to 11. Those 11 men, Lynn Huffman, they looked him in the eye for the first time. I mean, they're sitting in an upper room. They done went and locked themselves away because they're terrified. If the religious crowd crucified him for claiming to be the Son of God, they going to crucify us for following him. And so they kind of locked themselves away, kind of in hiding, if you will. And all of a sudden, the darnest thing happened. Jesus just walked right through the wall. Did not, I mean, no manners whatsoever, right? Just walked right into the wall. But here's the thing, folks. Those 11 men could not understand what it meant to be resurrected. They could. Now, they could see him, but you can't understand what it meant to be resurrected enough until you're on the other side of the grave. And that's why when you look at 1 Thessalonians 4, it said, even them which sleep in Jesus. Y'all know what that means? That means out here in the cemetery, there's a lot of folk that have died and went to hell. Not all of them to heaven. But then there's some folks out there that have died and went to heaven, David. And they are the only ones who know what that verse means. You and I, we talk about it, and we think about it, and we know what the Scripture says, but you really can't fathom what it means to be resurrected and have a resurrected body until you get on that side. Are y'all with me? And so when those men saw Jesus, they were like, man, that's crazy. And then here comes Thomas. He was not there. Paul said he wasn't in the room. Here comes Thomas. He shows up. Says, they said, hey, Thomas, you ain't gonna believe this man. Jesus is alive. Listen now. He would not believe the testimony of 11 men. 11 men could not persuade him. He said, I will not believe until I see and touch.
Amen.
Are y'all with me? Jesus gave him that opportunity. Listen, can I tell you something? The resurrection, because of the resurrection, we don't have to fear death, church. We don't, alright? Jesus did not just pay the price for our sin, he conquered the penalty for our sin. Because the wages of sin is, Jesus wiped all of it off the map, alright? But we can't understand that, Philip, till we get on the other side. I mean, we live in mortal, human, fleshly, can I say weak? We live in weak bodies and we make terrible decisions because we don't understand what it means to live in a glorified body. We never will until we get over there. And be unto, as sinners, we were the problem and the ones blessed. As sinners, we were the problem and yet we were the ones blessed. Luke 24, 6 and 7, he is not here but is risen. Remember how he spoke unto you when he was at Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered to the hands of sinful men. These certain two were sinful men. And be crucified, and the third day he will or he must rise again. Jesus was a man. Now listen, you and I were the cause of him going to the cross. You remember when the movie The Passion of Christ came out and everybody began to say that it was anti-Semitic, it was anti-Jewish, and people asked me, do you believe it was anti-Jewish? And I said, I got enough sins to worry about. I ain't got time to blame the Jewish people. I'm too busy to blame myself. Are y'all with me? And so here's Jesus. He's beaten. He's bloody. The Bible said he was beaten so bad he could stare at his bones. I mean, if you and I would have really seen what he looked like on that cross, it'd you make you throw up. All, John, not for his benefit, for us. But we missed something. There was a man that was a part of this equation that was going to change everything. And his name was Barabbas. Pilate knew, the Bible tells us, that Pilate knew they had delivered Jesus because they were jealous of him. They were envious. And so Pilate has determined in his heart, he said, I'm going to set him free. Now listen, what did they say? They said, if Jesus rises up to be a king, if enough people follow him, the Romans are going to take away our place and our nation. They were terrified of their own people. And so Jesus comes for Pilate. They said, hey, Pilate, he says he's a king. He's a threat to you. Pilate takes him in the back room, talks to Jesus proudly. Do you know? Tell me what truth is. You know the whole story. The Bible said Pilate come out and said, I find nothing wrong with this man. Nothing. He's an innocent man, done nothing wrong. And so the Bible tells us that at the Passover, it was a custom to release some of them a prisoner. Now, I studied this week, and this really hit me inside the head, Calvin, because I've been doing this for 17 years and never realized this this week. Why did he choose Barabbas? There's a reason why Pilate chose Barabbas that we don't even realize. I mean, he didn't bring a man out that had stole gum at the store down the street. He brought a man out who was a murderer. Why of all the people that he could have brought out to give an option beside Jesus, why Barabbas? I mean, here's a man that, now let's be honest about it. Barabbas was guilty, Jesus was innocent, and the innocent was going to die for the guilty. And the guilty was going to go free. Why Barabbas? If you study in the Bible said Barabbas was guilty of an insurrection. Y'all know what that means? Y'all know what that means? If you study that, not just biblically, but historically, y'all know why Barabbas was in prison? Because he led a revolt against the Roman Empire. Barabbas, when the Romans came in and took over, Barabbas was a thorn in their side. And the Bible said that the Romans arrested Barabbas because he basically committed treason against Rome. And so the Romans said, he will be crucified, treason is death. By the way, that ought to be the way it is in America too. The Romans said treason is death. And so here's Barabbas. Now think about this, Philip. If you say let Barabbas go free, what you're saying is you side with this man and you believe what he done is right. No Jew in his right mind is going to side with a man that led a revolt against Rome. He will reveal his own heart. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? So Pilate's thinking, there ain't no way they're going to side with Barabbas against a man who's done nothing but help people. There's only one problem. Jealousy can make you do some pretty dumb stuff. And the Bible says that the religious crowd have persuaded the multitude, tell them to crucify him. There's something else here, though. Y'all know what? Because of the power of Jesus, sometimes you gotta let people go that you don't want to. Hello, somebody. Because of Jesus, folks, sometimes you gotta forgive things you don't want to forgive. Oh, stuff got quiet now. If you don't know what they did to me, I don't give a rip what they done to you. Alright? Grow up. Immature Christians are killing the church. Alright? Watch this. Pilate never ever would have turned Barabbas loose. That man was a thorn in the side of Rome. And if we let him go, he liable to lead another revolt. And Pilate had to let a man go whom he'd rather not. You know why? Because of Jesus. Did y'all hear what I said? See, to some of the Jewish people, Barabbas was a hero. They would never admit they hated Rome, but inside they did. So who do you want? The king that can give you all eternity? Or the man that can give you a short life here and be a hero to you? See, we got too many folks, we worship humans instead of the divine God. Barabbas was a superhero to some of them. And so when you think about where they were at in the testimony, excuse me, all sinners, as sinners, we were the problem, the ones blessed. And then see, and number two, it is the source of our hope. It is the source of our hope. The resurrection is the source of our hope. 1 Peter 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. You need to write this down. That word hope in 1 Peter, it means a confident expectation. In other words, when we say that we have a hope, what we're saying is, I am confident that there is an expectation greater than I can see. Can I be honest with you, church? Without hope, life's pretty miserable, ain't it? You say, well, preacher, why in the world, why do you say you only live by hope and not live by fact? Because the fact is my hope. Now think about this for a minute. Think about this for a minute. You say, preacher, where would you be without Jesus Christ? I tell you where I'd be. I'd be lost on my way to hell in a miserable life. Preacher, where would you be without hope? Without hope, I'd be among men most miserable. That's why look at the way the verse ends. Which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope. Hey folks, my hope ain't written on pages. My hope is alive. It is a lively hope. And then look at the end of that verse, because this is good. By the resurrection, you know what it means? What he's saying is, I have a hope because Jesus Christ is alive. My hope is based on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hey, can I be honest with y'all? I love y'all, but my hope ain't in the church. Because the church... Anyway, I'll leave that there, all right? My hope is not based on the church. My hope is not based on people. My hope is not based on other pastors, even though there are some great ones. My hope is not based on the choir, even though they do an amazing job. My hope is, and your hope, better be rooted in one man. And I'm going to tell you why. People will let you down every time. People will disappoint you every time. Our hope has got to be rooted in one thing. Jesus Christ. Period. When folks make you disappointed, when folks deter you, when folks let you down, listen, the problem is we got our eyes on man, and that is a destructive problem. But let me tell you something, when you got your eyes on man, when they let you down, you'll drop out of church. You'll do it every time. And so his point here in 1 Peter's writing was, my hope is based on the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And then number three, what the resurrection does to us. What the resurrection does to us. I'm going to give you A and B under number three. A, it compels us, and B, it should make us focus all our worship on one person. It compels us, and it should make us focus all our worship on one person. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 in your outline. For the love of Christ constrains us. Or if you got a different version, it says compels us. Because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Now stop there. What he's saying in that verse is, he's saying if you really believe that Jesus Christ is alive, and if you really believe that he is the Son of God, and if you really believe that he is the way, truth, and the life, if you really believe that, then he and he alone should be the only one that you worship. Are y'all with me? Our problem is we want to worship people and materialism. You can tell you why that's a problem? Because that can't compel you enough to share the gospel with anybody. It can't. So here's my question this morning. What compels you to live for Christ? Can I just be very honest with you this morning? A lot of folks, they get upset by nothing. I'm talking about nothing. Alright? And then some folks, it don't matter what you say, you can't change their mind. And it's okay, all right? But here's my thing. People at all times want to find something negative about everything. Your hope and your focus can't be. thee in the living Jesus Christ. All right, quit being the problem and for once in your life, get a solution. That's what brings hope. You say, why? You know, I was thinking this week, and we talked about this last Sunday. Why would Jesus Christ go to the cross? You say, he had 11 men. I get all that. I get it. But why? And you know what the Lord showed me? Oh, we talked about last Sunday. He believes in us. You know what the Lord showed me this week? He done that for the same reason we preach the gospel. Why is it that when families and churches have problems, or when people are struggling with addictions, or when folks are in the pit of life, why is it that the pastor loses sleep and is stressed out? You know why? Because we care. Because I'll be honest with you, if I didn't care, it would bother. You know, I'm praying for you, bro. You know, kind of like most of y'all do, right? I'm praying for you, quick. But it's because we care. If we, you know, if every home in here falls apart, if I didn't care, it wouldn't bother me. All right? Why did Jesus Christ go to the cross? Because he cared. Why did he stand on top of a hill one day and look across Jerusalem and begin to cry? Because he cared. Why did he spend umpteen hours trying to teach these men? Because he cared. Can I tell you something, church? Jesus Christ cared. But it's got to be reciprocal. And then I put in 1 Corinthians 15:21. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. You say, well, preacher, that don't make no sense. How did death come by one man? It's very simple. It's a man by the name of Adam. By man came death, by man also came the resurrection of death. You say, but Jesus was fully God. You're right, but he was also fully man. And a lot of folks say, well, preacher, why do I have to pay a price because of Adam? Because if Adam had not blew it, you would have. And I would have. Because we're weak people.
That's right.
And then see, it removes our greatest fear. What does the resurrection really do? Matthew 28:5-6. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, fear not. Fear not. If you serve three words, fear not ye or you. For I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. Think about it. Nobody, and I mean this, nobody calls up their friend and says, hey, let's meet for lunch tomorrow and let's talk about death. Man don't like to talk about death because it brings fear to his heart. Now, I got to be honest with you. If death strikes a fear in your heart, then you might need to do some check up with the Lord. All right? And I thought, why? The Bible says he gives peace that surpasses all understanding. Now, I'll be honest with you. I'm ready to go, but I'm not in a hurry to go. All right? It's like I got my plane ticket, but I ain't catching a flight today if I can avoid it. All right? And the reason why is because anybody that is right with the Lord or knows the Lord and Savior, they're not afraid to die. But they don't want to leave their family. I mean, you don't want to leave your wife. You don't want to leave your kids. I mean, my wife can find another husband about beautiful as me. All right? But she can't. All right? My wife can find another husband, but she ain't going to find no man to love my little girl like me. It just ain't going to happen. And so nobody wants to leave their family. But the reality is this, though. Nobody knows when it's time to go. We've had several funerals in this county in the last few weeks that were complete out of the blue. Complete. And so the question is this, are you really prepared to die? Or does that strike terror in your heart? Because I'll be honest, that's where the road meets the road. When you get past all the decoration, that's where it gets real. Are you really ready? Because I'll be honest with you, May 15, 2002, when the Lord saved me, I realize a man's not ready to live until he's ready to die. When a man's prepared for death, he can enjoy life. He really can. But man, I've been doing this for 17 years now. And man, when you go into the room of a person, whether in a hospital or a home, when you go into the room of a person and they look you in the eye and they say, Pastor, I'm just ready to go. Friend, I'm going to tell you something. There ain't no psychiatrist or psychologist or no, there is no mind reader that can put that kind of peace in your heart. You can't do it. That's something that is supernatural. And I've witnessed it many times. And you, I mean, it don't matter if they're older in life or younger in life, because of terminal illness or whatever, it's all across the board. It just is. But when you go and, I mean, like Brother Bobby Hill, y'all heard me talk about it several times. That's the darnest thing I've ever seen in my life. I'm talking about a man that was fully coherent. And I told him, I said, Brother Bobby, you do understand that this is the final conversation you and I ever going to have beside each other. His family was there. He said, preacher, I'm just ready to go. When I walked out of that hospital and got on the elevator, I said, you can't buy that. You can't buy that. I'm not talking about knowing it could be tomorrow or a week. I'm talking about knowing that before the sun goes down today, that you leave in this world. Y'all know why, church? Because of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus can remove all your fears. See, a lot of you here today, you don't like to talk about death, but it troubles you. You know why? Because somewhere in the backside of your heart, you know you're not ready to die. But just be real about it. And then D, unfree. It sets us free from slavery. It sets us free from slavery. Romans 6, 5, 6. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that from now on we should not serve sin. Did y'all get that? Did y'all get that? Because of our old man being crucified, for we've been crucified with Christ, because our old man is crucified and our new man is renewed in Christ, can I ask you something? Don't you dare tell the world that you're a born-again Christian if you're still living like the old person. Don't you dare do that. Hey, can I just be honest with y'all? Y'all heard me say this before. If we're not going to live like Christians, let's do the whole world a favor and not tell nobody we are. Because a lot of people who claim to be Christians that live like the devil really mess things up for a man who's trying to witness to somebody who don't want to hear it. Are y'all hearing me? Can't listen, church. We don't live. Inside of us does not dwell the dead Christ. Inside of us dwells the risen Christ. So therefore, live like the new man. Amen? You say, well, how do you do that? Well, I'll tell you one thing. You can't do it on your own. We have been transformed by the renewing of our mind. Your actions begin in your mind. And so wherever your mind is, that's where your actions will be. Amen? So the question is this. Are we living like the old man or living like the new man? That is the question. You can't claim the resurrection is real if it's not real in your life. That's just simple. And then number four, and I'm moving on. What the resurrection gives us. What the resurrection gives us. A and number four, the power of Christ. Philippians 3:10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. Need to circle in three words, may know him. That word means personal. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. You say, preacher, how can you know the true power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Because you can look over your shoulder and see where the old man used to live, and you can see a point in your life where Jesus buried the old man, and then you can see a point in your life where you now have the new man. You know what that's called? That's called the power of the resurrection. However, I will give you a very good warning sign, all right? And the warning sign is this. Whenever we come to Jesus Christ and repent of our sins, we become a new man, then, huh? The old man's in our rearview mirror. But y'all know what? Y'all know how on cars nowadays is that objects may be closer than they appear. That's where the old man's at. He ain't far behind. We sing a song in our church. It's called "The Old Man Is Dead." That's a lie. Way down deep inside of us is the old man, and all he's waiting on is about 5 minutes to get out. I'm telling you. And listen, if we ain't careful, our emotions will get the best of us, And before you know it, Michael Jackson, the old man is beginning to crawl out of our, I'm telling you, it's dangerous. To be honest with you, it's frightening to how fast we can. I told a guy the other week, and I was just aggravating him, but he didn't aggravate me. I said, I've been saved now for 15 years. I ain't been in a fight in 15 years, but I'm about to take all 15 years off you. All right? old man is not far behind, I'm telling you. And so you have to be careful, David. I said it, all right? And so the old man is there. Leonhoff, here's what the Apostle Paul said. The Apostle Paul said, I die every day to myself. If a man like the Apostle Paul had to get up every morning and bury an old man, how much more do we have to? Are y'all with me? We understand the power of the resurrection, but we also understand that inside of us is still this humanity, and it's dangerous. And then be under the Lord. True confidence in the Word of God. True confidence in the Word of God. 1 Corinthians 15:3-4. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. How Christ died for our sins, and he's underlined that statement according to the Scripture. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scripture. Listen, can I tell y'all something? The Word of God, everybody look at me. The Word of God is so powerful and amazing. Let me tell you why. The Word of God, the Bible that you and I have in our hands and in our homes, the Word of God was written over a 1,600-year span. It was written in three different languages off of three different continents by 40 different writers, most of which never knew one another, And yet, when you take all their writings and collaborate them, they fit together like a glove. Folks, that is not a coincidence. You can't have 10,000 coincidences. You can't. And so here's the reason I say that. The Bible said that everything was based on according to the Scripture. If you do not believe in the resurrection, then you might well go the rest of the Bible away. Because it's all according to Scripture. Y'all know why you put confidence in it? Because everything it says is, especially in the day that we live, you can look around us and see the Bible being fulfilled. If you don't believe the resurrection, you can't believe in the garden. If you don't believe in the resurrection, you can't believe in the book of Exodus, because the book of Exodus is about revival. It's about a new beginning. Amen? Amen? So do you really believe it? Or do you just own it? See, I'm a firm believer that most folks really don't believe the Bible. You can't tell me that you believe that book and it not impact your life. That's a lie. There's no way you can really believe the Bible and it not change your life. That's impossible. That's impossible. So do we really believe it? As Jesus asked Lazarus' sister, do you really believe this? Do you really believe that I can do what I'm about to tell you? Do you really believe it? And by the way, she didn't ask her sister, Leonhoff, and he didn't ask Lazarus, he asked her. It's got to be personal. If you're the one with the issue, then do you really believe this? And then the finale, do you believe this? If so, what impact have you allowed it to have in your life? Do you believe this? And if so, what impact do you allow it to have in your life? You can put your outlines away and just listen close. Say, preacher, other than the Bible, what example do you really believe makes the Bible true? Other than the Bible, what do you really believe makes the resurrection true? Alright, think about this for a minute. Alright, let's put aside our spirituality for a minute and let's just think logically. Alright, be intelligent for a minute. I don't mean that negative, alright? Let's just say, Philip. Let's just say for argument's sake, everybody listen to me. Let's just say for argument's sake that they did steal his body. Let's just say for argument's sake that Jesus was not resurrected. Let's just say that they took his body, Leonhoff, and they went and hid it somewhere in order that nobody would find it and that they wouldn't have to look embarrassed and they wouldn't have to look foolish. Let's just say that they stole his body. Hypothetically. And let's just say that after they stole his body and went hit it, Mike Jackson, by the way, they hit it pretty good, but 2,000 years, they ain't profound. Let's just say that these 11 disciples said, you know what, man, I ain't gonna look like a fool to the world. We're gonna take his body, and we're gonna go hide it, and we're gonna tell everybody in 3 days he's alive. That's what we're gonna do. And then after they hit his body, Calvin, they went to this upper room where nobody's there but them. And they collaborated this story, saying, listen, if anybody asks us what happened, we're going to tell them he's alive. We're going to tell them we've seen him, and we're going to tell them that he preached to us, and we're going to tell them that he went before us into Galilee. I mean, man, all 11 of them has got to believe this story. Are you with me to this point? And so let's just say, for argument's sake, that these 11 apostles went and buried his body. Nobody has found it. They have collaborated this story that we're going to go, and man, we're going to preach the gospel to the world, and we're just going to tell them that he's alive. That would be believable. Except for one problem. Many of you may know, and most of you probably do not. When Judas went and hung himself, in the book of Acts, there was a man by the name of Matthias that took his place. The Bible said they cast lots, a lot fell on him. He joined those 11 men to make 12 disciples again. There's only one problem with that whole story, Philip. Let's say they did steal his body. Let's say they did hide it. Let's say that they came up with this story, that they're going to tell everybody he's alive and preach the gospel to the world. There's only one problem with that. Out of those 12 men that were left, do you know that 11 of them died as martyrs? There was only one of those 12 men that died an old man, and that was John. The rest of them were tortured, beaten, and killed for doing nothing but preaching the gospel. Now, anybody with a logical brain in their head knows that one of them 11, at some point in time, between being beaten and being tortured to death, they would have confessed, listen, we made it all up, man. If you'll just quit beating me to death, we made it all up. I don't care what the other 11 said, it's a fake. We stole his body. Listen, if you quit beating me, I'll take you and show you where it's at. Don't y'all think with a logical brain in your head, one of them would have cracked? Don't y'all think so? But 11 men were willing to be tortured and beaten and murdered because they knew Jesus was alive. No man is going to be beaten for something that's not true. One of them 12, David, would have gave in and said, we fabricated all of it. But instead, they were willing to go to their graves because they knew Jesus was alive. Amen? 11 men are not going to die for a vicious life. Not the way some of them were beaten to death. I mean, Peter was crucified hanging upside down. He is not going to allow nails to be driven through his hand and through his feet for something he fabricated. Nobody in their right mind would do that. Can I tell you something? The Bible said the resurrection love of Christ compels us. They were compelled to die for what they believed in because they knew Jesus was alive. Can I ask you a question? Are we ready to die for it? Because we very well may be called upon to do so. And not just them 12 men or 11, because John died an old man. Not just them 11 men. But every day on the globe somewhere, John, there's a believer being murdered for their faith. Every day people are still believing or still dying because they believe it's true. These 11 men couldn't fabricate such a story. They couldn't live out such a lie. And by the way, it's not just a biblical account, it's a historical account. Hey, listen, church. It's Easter. Tomorrow, Easter's going to be over. But guess what? Tomorrow morning, he's still going to be alive. It's not a one-day event. It's not a one-day event. And so let's all stand. Heads bowed, eyes closed. I just want you to think for a minute.